The subject of today's lecture is pulsars. But before we come to pulsars, I want to tell you a story, a very remarkable story, almost a fairy tale. This is the story of the Crab Nebula. Now, the Crab Nebula, a famous Dutch astronomer, Jan Oort, said, astronomy is divided into two halves, the study of the Crab Nebula and the rest of the universe. So more effort has been spent trying to understand this nebula than any other object in the sky. And the story I'm going to tell you is a true story about this object. This object was first discovered or noticed by the great French astronomer Messier. He was following Halley's comet, and the comet happened to be in the constellation Taurus, Taurus the bull, being chased by Orion the hunter with his faithful dog Sirius, which we encountered in the second lecture. So when he was looking in the constellation Taurus, tracing Halley's comet, he found this object. So in his famous catalog, this is object number one. So the Crab Nebula is M1 in the catalog of objects. And then in the 19th century, it looked like a crab to Lord Rosse in England. And so the name Crab Nebula was given to this. In the 1920s, Hubble discovered by studying the filaments, the spectrum of the filaments of the Crab Nebula, and by measuring the Doppler shift of known lines, he deduced that the Crab Nebula was expanding with a velocity of about 1,500 kilometers per second. Now, here is another way of demonstrating that expansion. What is shown here is a positive image of the Crab Nebula and a negative image of the Crab Nebula taken 10 years apart, put on top of one another. If the nebula was not expanding, then the positive and negative images will cancel out. But they don't cancel out. So this clearly shows that the nebula is either expanding or contracting, okay, one of the two. Then in the 1930s or early 1940s, the great Dutch astronomer Jan Oort wanted to know whether the Crab Nebula is associated with any of the guest stars that the Chinese had studied. So he had a friend in the history department of Leiden, and so he told him, you know, will you collaborate with me and let us go and study the historical records of the guest stars of the Chinese. And they found that the location of the center of the Crab Nebula coincided precisely with this guest star of 1054 AD. And we know post-1933, post-Bader and Zwicky, that these guest stars were really supernovae. So it was identified that the Crab Nebula is the remnant of the supernova explosion that occurred in the year 1054 AD, 4th of July. 4th of July is American Independence Day. America didn't exist at that time. Okay. It belonged to different people who were exterminated by people who now live in America. Now, the remarkable thing that was noticed about the Crab Nebula is there are two kinds of emission in the visible. You have filamentary emission, and if you send the light through this, from this through a spectrograph, you find line emission. But then in addition, you find an object in the center of it, which is like a fried egg, which is a continuum emission. It doesn't have, it is like the light from a, not from a tube light, but the old-fashioned incandescent filament light. If you send that light through a prism, you won't have any spectral lines. It's just black body continuum. This is the first object in the sky from which this continuum radiation was ever detected. It had never been seen before in any other object. So in this modern picture, Hubble Space Telescope picture of the Crab Nebula, you see very clearly the diffuse emission, the bluish emission in the center. And our story is essentially centered on the diffuse emission. Jan Oort and his collaborators in Holland, in a very famous observation, showed that the continuum emission from the Crab Nebula is very strongly linearly polarized, which is shown in this diagram. The arrows represent the direction of polarization. This was the very first astronomical source from which polarized radiation was detected. Very first astronomical source. Then Walter Bade of Bade and Zwicky fame noticed that right at the center of the Crab Nebula, there is a star, that star over there. If you extrapolate the velocity vectors that pointing outwards, backwards, they meet at that point. So Walter Bade had identified the center of the supernova explosion as the location of the central star. And you notice that every now and then there is dramatic brightening or expanding wisps. It appeared as though something was emanating from the central star and moving outwards. It's a bit weird. The explosion happened 1,000 years ago. There is nothing there. But Walter Bade was not a nobody. He was Walter Bade, who, along with Zwicky in 1934, had postulated that the supernova explosion arises because a neutron star was formed. So what he said in 1942 was that there is a stellar remnant of that explosion, and that star is the stellar remnant of that explosion. In other words, that is the neutron star from that explosion. Please remember, nobody else in the world apart from these two gentlemen, much later Landau and Lipschitz statistical physics, believed about neutron stars. They only discovered that much later, and that's the story of today's lecture. What Walter Bade noticed was something absolutely extraordinary. He noticed that when you extrapolate this expanding velocity vectors backwards in time, they did not meet in the year 1054 AD. They met in a year which is 80 years later. The explosion to him appeared as though it occurred in the year 1100 and something rather than 1054 AD. Therefore, Walter Bade concluded that the Crab Nebula is not only expanding, but must be accelerating. This is absolutely weird. We all know, star exploded, it's gone. Then the debris must follow Newton's first law, and then by energy conservation, it should slow down, slow down, slow down, and come to a stop. How can it be accelerating? Like the universe accelerating. Right? This is 1942. So he went on to conjecture that some sort of a wind must be emanating from the stellar remnant which is causing the acceleration of the nebula. Absolute science fiction. Right? But Walter Bade was no ordinary astronomer. Then we move on from 1942 to 1949. We go to Sydney in Australia. In 1949, the war had just ended in 1945, and there was hardly any money to even eat properly, let alone to do research or build telescope. John Bolton was an astronomer. He worked on radar during the Second World War. So he wanted to pursue radio astronomy. Now, the only radio telescopes one had those days was what is called as a simple Yagi antenna. I don't know how many of you remember the days, you're all so young, you may not remember the days before cable TV. When you had to watch only Doordarshan, you in the terrace of your house, you put up an antenna which consisted of a rod. Those are dipoles, okay? Those are called Yagi dipoles. So that's all you could afford. But a Yagi dipole, we saw yesterday's lecture, that a dipole radiates in all directions, therefore it will also receive from all directions. Therefore the dipole doesn't have any pointing accuracy. I cannot say, I'm looking at the Crab Nebula, you're looking everywhere. But he said, I want to be able to look properly. We know that to look properly, you have to build a big telescope, because Rayleigh's criterion for resolving power is lambda by D. Yes, go and build yourself a bigger and bigger telescope like GMRT, 45 meters in diameter. You couldn't do that in 1949, there was no money for it. So John Bolton did something terribly clever. He found a cliff near Sydney, and on the cliff, he put a Yagi antenna. And that's what I've shown in the picture over there. That is the cliff. There is the Yagi antenna. The Yagi antenna receives radiation from an astronomical source, but it also receives radio radiation from that same source reflected off the sky. So it is almost as though the mirror image of this telescope, and this is the surface of the sea, there was another telescope. This is called Lloyd's mirror. We used to do that experiment in college. So you take a nice piece of glass plate and you show it like this at glancing angle, you'll see interference fringes. Because in your eye, the direct beam and the reflected beam meet and produce interference. So this is a very remarkable thing. And then during the day, the sea level will change because of the tides. Therefore, it will be reflected off the point of the things that will meet in phase will correspond to reflection from different parts of the sky, depending on the height of the sea. So he observed this over 6 hours or 8 hours. And it is almost that he had a set of interferometers, Michelson interferometers. By combining this data, he discovered that the Crab Nebula was emitting radio radiation. Till 1949, there was only one known source of radio radiation. Although radio waves were discovered in 1928 in Bell Telephone Laboratory by Karl Jansky, we didn't know from where it was coming, except for one source, and that source was the sun. But that was a secret. That was a secret, closely guarded secret. So if you look at old Second World War movies, when the Royal Air Force jet fighter, not those days they didn't have jet fighters, fighter planes took off from England to go and bomb Germany, they would always take off at sunset time, so that if you're in Germany over there, looking west towards England, the sun was over there. They knew the Germans had invented radar, and they knew the sun was emitting radio waves. So when the German radars are trying to track the plane, their radar is jammed by the radio radiation from the sun. So that the sun was emitting radio radiation was one of the closely guarded secrets during the wartime. Okay? So the Crab Nebula was the second identified source of radio radiation. And it was a very powerful source of radio emission. Then came a great prediction by the very clever theoretical physicist Shklovsky in Moscow. Shklovsky asserted that the continuum optical emission from the Crab Nebula, for which there was no other counterpart in any other celestial object, he said, look, friends, this is not thermal radiation, this is synchrotron radiation. Synchrotron radiation arising from relativistic particles gyrating in the magnetic field. Of course, astronomers hadn't heard of synchrotron radiation because synchrotron had been just made in Berkeley in California in the university, only one synchrotron in the whole world. But Stravinsky was paying attention to it, and he said, this continuum radiation is synchrotron radiation. Seemed like a weird thing said by a crazy physicist, so don't pay any attention. But Stravinsky said, look, you can't dismiss me like that. I'm going to make a prediction. If it is synchrotron radiation, it will be linearly polarized. We already know that the optical radiation was linearly polarized. But he was now talking about the radio radiation. He said, okay, go and measure the polarization of the radio waves you have just discovered. I predict that it will be linearly polarized. A bunch of Russian radio astronomers in 1960 found that the Crab Nebula radio emission was very strongly linearly polarized. You see those vectors, it's either the electric field or the magnetic field. I don't remember the convention used, but it is a strongly linearly polarized source, confirming that it is synchrotron emission. Okay, synchrotron emission, who cares? There has to be some mechanism. Yeah. Then something dramatic happened. Two physicists in MIT in Boston flew a suborbital rocket in 1962, and they detected X-rays from the direction of the Crab Nebula. They were nuclear physicists in background. And these rockets just went up above the atmosphere for a short time, and then they re-entered the Earth. So for about a few minutes, 3 or 4 minutes, they are above the Earth's atmosphere. And then they had crude X-ray detectors, and they were able to detect X-rays. But then these X-rays could have come from anywhere. Then they used a very clever technique of lunar occultation. In other words, the disk of the moon acts as a diffraction edge. And from the diffraction pattern, you can determine the direction. The Ooty telescope became world famous by using this technique. And so they knew that Crab Nebula was emitting X-rays. This is the first source from which X-rays were detected. Then Sklovsky rubbed it in. Sklovsky said, this X-ray emission is also synchrotron emission. So you'll say, well, very well, why not? It could be synchrotron emission. But he pointed out something which I rushed through in the previous lecture, we went through that. He said, but these electrons which are radiating in X-rays and in visible wavelength were not produced in the supernova explosion. Because he said, these would have become so tired because the frequency of X-rays is so large, the synchrotron lifetime, the energy of the particle divided by dE by dt, that time is very, very short, 20 years. But you're talking of an explosion that happened 1,000 years ago. Therefore, Sklovsky said, the relativistic particles that are producing the visible radiation and radio radiation have been produced more or less today or day before yesterday or last year or something like that. It seemed like an atrocious statement. Nothing is there. It all happened 1,000 years earlier. Then you also need magnetic field for the synchrotron radiation. Now you'll say, well, the star had a magnetic field. Therefore, when the star exploded, the debris will have a magnetic field. He said, that won't work. Because just as a gas, when it expands, cools and loses internal energy, this is the first law of thermodynamics, magnetic field and radiation, everything will also lose energy in an adiabatic expansion. So he said the magnetic field produced by the supernova explosion isn't going to help you. So he said there must be a central engine in the Crab Nebula which produces every single day without fail both relativistic particles as well as magnetic field. Fantasy. So here is the great puzzle. First question is, what is causing the acceleration of the nebula? Two, what are the wisps that appear every now and then due to. Three, what is continuing to supply relativistic electrons that are responsible for the radio optical X-ray emission from the Crab Nebula? And four, what is the origin of the magnetic field of the nebula itself? If there is a central engine inside the Crab Nebula, what kind of energy output it must have? Well, the luminosity of the Crab Nebula is 10 to the power 38 Hertz per second. It's measured. So the central engine must supply at least 10 to the power 38 Hertz per second and should have been doing so for the last 1,000 years. The question was, what is this central engine? Then Franco Pacini, a very dear friend of mine who is no more, he has been here many times. He was a young astronomer in Cornell at the time, working as a postdoc. He had a remarkable idea. And the idea was the following. He said, look, if at the center of the Crab Nebula, there was a rapidly spinning, strongly magnetized neutron star, then that will solve your problem. Just remember, nobody had found neutron stars. These were all conjectures of 30, 35 years earlier, right? Why did he say that? What are the properties we expect of a neutron star? We expect its mass to be about 1.4 solar mass. We expect it to be about 10 kilometers in radius and a mean density of 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. We also expect it to be spinning very rapidly. Why? The original star of radius R1 and angular velocity omega collapses to a much smaller radius R2. Therefore, the conservation of angular momentum, which is I omega is equal to constant, tells me that omega 1 R1 squared must be equal to omega 2 R2 squared. And since R2 is much smaller than R1, omega 2 must be much larger than omega 1. You also expect the neutron star to have a very strong magnetic field of the order of 10 to the power 12 Gauss, and Ginsberg had already conjectured this in 1964. And the argument is again very, very elementary. Because the star is completely ionized, it is an electrically conducting medium. In an electrically conducting medium, magnetic flux is frozen in. So if I compress the object, the magnetic field will get compressed. So when I compress a star with a magnetic surface magnetic field of strength B1 of radius R1, to a radius R2, then the magnetic field will be amplified by the relation B1 R1 squared is equal to B2 R2 squared. Flux is the number of field lines crossing a unit area. So the surface area is 4 pi R1 squared, 4 pi R2 squared. Therefore, a simple estimate tells you that a neutron star can have a field much in excess of 10 to the power 12 Gauss. What has that got to do with the price of fish? Well, Pacini said, let us remember Larmor's formula. If I have an electron which is accelerating with an acceleration A, then it loses energy at a rate which is given by 2e squared by 3 cubed, c cubed, square of the acceleration. And as we discussed in the last lecture, that formula can be rewritten as 2 over 3 c cubed, square of the second time derivative of the dipole moment. And the luminosity of this rotating dipole or oscillating dipole, the energy radiated per unit time, is proportional to the fourth power of the frequency. This is why I went through this derivation in the previous lecture, Rayleigh's law. Now, Pacini said, this will apply equally well for a rotating magnet, because a rotating magnet has a magnetic moment. And the magnetic moment of a sphere is Br cubed. where B is the magnetic field strength and R is the radius. So the formula for the luminosity of a rotating magnet is exactly the same as the formula for the luminosity of a rotating dipole, except instead of electric dipole, you replace it with a magnetic dipole moment M. And since the magnetic dipole moment is B times R cubed, I have the simple relation that the luminosity or the energy radiated per unit time is proportional to B squared omega to the power 4. The luminosity is proportional to the square of the magnetic field and fourth power of the frequency. So what he said was that if, for example, there is a neutron star at the center of the Crab Nebula, and if it is spinning with a period of a few milliseconds, and if its magnetic field is of the order of 10 to the power 12 Gauss, that previous formula will give me a luminosity of 10 to the power 38 x per second, and that will do the job for me. So it was a small paper in Nature, half a page long, which went unnoticed. So let's go from Cornell in America to Cambridge in England. In Cavendish Laboratory, where I worked before I came here, is a group of radio astronomers. And at that time, they were studying a phenomena which had recently been discovered in Cambridge, which is known as scintillation of radio sources. Now, you know that in visible light, if you look at stars, stars twinkle. And that is simply because the refractive index of the air is changing with time because the air is boiling due to convection. In the same way, radio radiation from distant objects like quasars, provided they are point objects, I mean, appearance-wise, so subtend a very small solid angle like stars, then because there are electrons in interstellar space, they will also twinkle. This is known as scintillation. It was a newly discovered phenomenon. Here is those days you didn't have electronic detectors, you had chart recorders, piece of graph paper which will move, and there's a pen which will move, which is measuring the voltage from some detector, and it'll draw. So what is shown here is an actual chart recorder drawing of some quasar 3C2, some object 3C270. You notice that it appears and then disappears. But then you look here, this 2C298, there is strong scintillation. And the time scale of the scintillation is the order of minutes. In the case of the twinkling stars, the time scale is of the order of tens of milliseconds. The persistence vision time scale of our eye is 50 milliseconds. So the time scales are very different. Fine. A young student like you, Jocelyn Bell, 20 years old at the time, was working with this radio telescope. This radio telescope doesn't look like any radio telescope you've seen, just a bunch of poles with dipoles stuck to them. This is a telescope exactly like this, not far from Bangalore and Gauri Bisnur, where Raman Institute and Indian Institute of Astrophysics operate a telescope. It's just a 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer of poles. And these, it's perfectly good at low frequency telescope. It's an interferometer. Each pole is one element of an interferometer. Jocelyn Bell's thesis project was to study scintillation of the sources, a phenomena that had just been discovered in Cambridge. One of the many students working on the scintillation. So one day, there was a party in her professor's house because one of the students had just completed the thesis, and so there was a party to celebrate a student's thesis. So everybody was having a good time except Jocelyn, because she had observing that night, and time at the telescope is too precious, so there she was observing. And what she found was the following. She found that in addition to the known scintillating sources, there was a source, a 19 plus 21, that is the coordinate of the source, 19 hours, 19 minutes, 21 degrees declination, she found an unknown source which was scintillating. Now, this could be just a truck going by, because the spark plugs of a truck produce electromagnetic radiation. And then if you go to Ooty, there are potato fields, and there are these guys with pesticide sprayers on their back. They'll go going around spraying, and those pesticide, those things spray electromagnetic radiation and so on. It could be just interference. But being a good scientist already at the age of 20s, he said, look, I'm not going to dismiss it as noise due to some passing truck or something else. I'm going to study this very carefully. And then she noticed, she gave it a name, the coordinate Cambridge source, pulsating source, 1919, date 6th August. This is the actual chart recorder from that date. And there is that little thing, that's all, thing going up and down, 6th August 1967. So she missed a nice party, she found some crazy looking object, nobody knew what it was. And then the worst thing was, next day it disappeared. It didn't exist anymore. But then, many months later, on the 28th of November, that object appeared again. And this time, she looked at that object a little more carefully. And then she found that what seemed to be some interference, noise, by some man-made object, actually seemed to be sort of periodic pulses. Okay. This is the very first observation of pulses. And she noticed that they seem to be occurring at precisely equal intervals of time. Some pulses are missing, but then when they appeared where they should have appeared had it been a periodic phenomenon. And she was smart enough to notice that also. And here it is, the pulsation from the very first object. And then, secrecy was clamped. In the Cavendish laboratory, only 4 people knew about this. The great Ginsberg from Moscow, Landau's collaborator, was spending a year in the Cavendish laboratory. He knew all about neutron stars. He had predicted superconductivity, superfluidity, magnetic field. He didn't know anything about it. For 6 months, there was complete secrecy, typical of Cambridge. I worked there, I know how they function. They said, we are going to study this carefully and do everything that anybody else in the world can possibly do about that. That's hallmark of a good scientist, right? And then, a paper appeared in Nature in February 1968. By Hewish et al. There were several authors. Et al. In Latin means "and others." Usually you mention only the first name. So I invented the convention, Hewish Bell et al. Otherwise the person who discovered it, the name is missing from the paper. Okay? It's very unfair, she's the one who discovered it. So it's an unusual convention that I introduced, Hewish Bell et al. Now this paper, one Saturday morning, when I was a student in Chicago, I was in the library of the Fermi Institute, and somebody coughed, and I turned around, and there was Chandrasekhar standing there. And he said, well, what do you think of it? What do we think of what? You know, I mean, yesterday's baseball game, or a movie I went to, or something like that. He said, I didn't say anything, but he guessed that I didn't know what he was talking about. He said, have you seen the latest Nature? I never read Nature. I was working in solid state physics. Only astronomers read Nature, or biologists. I never read Nature. So he said, he picked it up and gave it to me and made me read that paper standing right in front of him. And then he said, well, what do you think? I didn't say anything because I had nothing to say. He said, it must be a neutron star. I remember this 50 years ago. I remember this till today. Now, one of the things that Jocelyn and her professor Anthony Hewis thought was this could be signals from the little green men on Mars. Don't laugh. All the time we've been saying that there must be people trying to send signal. And here is a signal, periodic. Why shouldn't it be some little green or blue man from Mars or one of the other planets? She said, no, it cannot be, because she noticed that every day that source was rising 4.5 minutes later. That meant that the sidereal time of the rising source was different from the solar time. And that meant this object was outside the solar system. Immediately, they knew this is, it cannot be little green man on Mars or any other planet. It's outside of a solar system. Then they discovered they are observing at some frequency, but this is not monochromatic radiation. Radio receivers have a certain bandwidth, a few kilohertz or a few megahertz or whatever it is. It receives radiation at all those frequencies. They noticed that this pulse was not arriving at the same time at all the frequencies. Here is a modern picture. What is shown here on the vertical axis is the frequency. What is shown on the horizontal axis is the time when the pulse actually arrives. See, each one of these is a pulse. So you notice high frequencies arrive earlier, low frequencies arrive later. This is just like white light being bent by a prism, because the refractive index depends on frequency. So if the refractive index is due to electrons in this case, then you would expect the lower frequency to come later, because the refractive index is the square root of the dielectric constant. And the dielectric constant is 1 minus omega p squared divided by omega squared, where omega p squared is the plasma frequency. Doesn't matter, there's a 1 over omega squared. That means lower frequencies will be delayed more. This is what we call as dispersion, right? Splitting of white light into many colors. So immediately they knew from this phenomena that this pulsar or whatever it is, we don't know, is very far away. And this dispersion is arising due to electrons in the interstellar space. That also they deduce. They also notice the following thing. This is not the picture of that pulsar, but a more modern picture. What they notice is here are the pulses on the top of some pulsar. Looks like a spike. But if you look at it with lot of time resolution, fine time resolution, what seems like a delta function is actually a broad pulse lasting so many microseconds or milliseconds or whatever it is. And then inside that pulse, there are substructures. Okay, there are substructures. That means what you have is the following thing, that you find that the radiation is coherent over some time scale delta t, which is a small time scale. You can read off the time scale here, milliseconds, few milliseconds. Now, if delta t is of the order of few milliseconds, then immediately you know the following. You know that the size of the object has to be less than c delta t. So imagine this campus is filled with little radio telescopes, antennas, all over the campus, all over Bangalore. We are rich, we can put radio telescopes every few meters all over Bangalore. And then we say, and I say, I'm the boss, I say, when I say now, all of you will send out a pulse in that direction. Fine, there's no problem. We agree on it. We meet in a room like this, we agree on it. So then I give signal. You agree with me that only those antennas, if I'm dealing with a certain time delta t, from the moment I give the signal, at the time delta t, that information has only gone to a distance c delta t. So only those antennas will emit the radiation. Therefore, when I'm looking from far away, If the characteristic time scale of the fluctuation in the intensity is delta t, then I immediately know that the size of the emitting region cannot be more than c delta t. Then immediately Jocelyn deduced that the size of this object, at least the radiating region of that object, is only a few thousands of kilometers. You don't have stars of few thousands of kilometers, millions of kilometers, tens of millions of kilometers. So astronomers have only encountered two objects, one object, and one was theory. You will like that. There was a theory of a neutron star. One object was 10,000 kilometers in radius, measured, seen. The other was a theoretical conjecture of an object 10 kilometers in size. Nothing else. But they knew that it cannot be a planet because the amount of energy that they were getting from this object is something, you know, the total amount of energy an object can emit is only mc squared. You can't say I'm so privileged that it is spending all its energy because I'm watching it and day after tomorrow it's going to disappear. That's not a very, that's a pre-Copernican attitude, right? So you must assume an astronomical source will last for millions of years. There's nothing privileged about it. So immediately they knew it cannot be a planetary mass object. It can be, it has to be a stellar mass object, but of a planetary size. Only two such objects that were known or conjectured, neutron star or white dwarf. It must also produce pulses of radiation. There you see it. So these pulses must be due to some reason. The object could be rotating, or the object could be vibrating, or there could be two objects going around each other. These are the only three things that most of us can think of producing some periodic phenomenon. Now here is something very interesting. I want you to think about it. If you take the Earth and I ask, I want to put something, a satellite in orbit, gracing the surface of the Earth. What will be its orbital period? You know how to solve this problem. Mv squared by r is gmm over r squared, and you solve that and you get the period. You'll find that the characteristic time scale tau is of the order of 1 over square root of g times the density of the Earth. Mass, radius can be written as a density. Now I say, I dig a tunnel through the Earth and I drop a tennis ball. You know it'll oscillate. I tell you to calculate the period of that oscillation. And you'll find the characteristic time scale is 1 over square root of 0. Then I take a big hammer and hit the Earth. It'll vibrate. There'll be all kinds of vibrations. I ask, what is the characteristic vibrational time scale? It is 1 over square root of 0. Okay? Think about why it is so, right? All right. So because I know what white dwarf size is, what its mass is, and therefore what its density is, I can calculate what its typical vibrational time scale. I can do the same for neutron star. 10 to the power 14 grams per cubic centimeter. Then I can have an object which is rotating. So if the centrifugal force cannot overwhelm gravity, so 1 second, you can ask which object, can an object rotate at a period of 1 second? Why doesn't it blow itself apart from centrifugal forces? Then can two objects go around each other with an orbital period of 1 second? So they did all these calculations and they came to the conclusion, we are dealing with an object which is pulsating with a period of 1 second. We can't rule out either of them. So the paper concluded with the conjecture that it is either a white dwarf or a neutron star. They couldn't say it had to be a neutron star, it had to be a white dwarf. Both were admissible at a period of 1 second. Fine. Then they also came to the conclusion that the radio radiation they observe is coherent, like a laser or a maser. How did they come to this remarkable conclusion? Now, one of the first things a radio astronomer measures, calculates from observation, it is what is known as a brightness temperature. Brightness temperature is the following. At some frequency nu equal to nu naught, the person measures a certain amount of intensity. That much intensity at that frequency within a certain bandwidth. Then you ask, what is the temperature of a hypothetical black body that will go through that point? Now you may say, well, that's not very easy. I could have a situation something like this. I could have all kinds of black body curves. You can't do that. Because a black body curve is uniquely characterized by only one parameter, which is the temperature. Therefore, through any point in this plane, you can draw one and only one black body curve. Therefore, all I have to know is that the intensity at one frequency, then I know what should be the temperature of a hypothetical black body. We are not saying this object is a black body. We are saying, imagine it is a black body. Then what should its temperature be in order to emit that much intensity at that frequency? That's what radio astronomers call as the brightness temperature. It is a certain number. That number does not necessarily correspond to the temperature of that object. That number came to some ridiculous number like 10 to the power 25 Kelvin. That's what it will come to if you take a laser or a maser. You get a brightness temperature of 10 to the power 30 Kelvin. But surely that laser, the laser in this pointer is not at a temperature of 10 to the power 25 Kelvin. So there is a problem. And the problem is what I alluded to in the last lecture. What is plotted here in the y-axis is the intensity, and on the x-axis is the frequency. And that blue curve is a black body curve corresponding to a certain temperature, capital T. Now, what my physics and thermodynamics tells me is, an object at any given frequency can only radiate an amount which is less than the amount it would radiate if it behaved like a black body. In other words, this rectangular yellow thing is allowed, this is allowed, but the red is not allowed. Because if the red is allowed, then I can construct a perpetual engine of two bodies which are at the same temperature. Why is this? This is happening because when you send radiation through matter, we normally think of the radiation being attenuated because it is absorbed. But under certain circumstances, matter can also act as an amplifier. And we have known it now for 50 years or more, that there are certain situations where the population inversion occurs, where the ratio of number of particles occupying higher level is more than the number at the lower level, where you violate the principle of thermodynamic equilibrium, you can have amplification. So immediately they deduce from this paper that the radio radiation from this pulsar, whatever this object may be, has to be coherent in the sense of a laser, radiation from a laser or a maser. All these things were deduced before they sent the paper for publication. Do we understand this till today? Well, this is not fully understood. It means you got to have like in a klystron. I hope you know what a klystron is. That's what produces microwave in your kitchen, microwave heater. And that's what was first discovered for the radar. Particles are bunched. And then you're talking of radiation like we discussed in the previous lecture, whose wavelength is very large compared to the size of the system. So the N antennas in that bunch are not radiating incoherently. Therefore, the total intensity is not proportional to N, but N squared. That is what coherence means, right? So they wrote a paper. twinkle, twinkle, little star, and the last sentence of the paper is, it must be either a white dwarf or a neutron star. So you see a number of remarkable deductions from a very simple observation. So I hope that will give you some flavor for how experimental physics should be approached. So soon after that paper appeared in the literature, somebody said, hey, look, long time ago, Baden and Zwicky said, there should be a neutron star at the center of supernova explosion. Go and look at the center of the Crab Nebula. And the Canadians pointed the telescope, and there it was. There was a pulsar neutron star there. That was Bode's star. That was the very same star that Bode pointed out in 1942. How do we know that? Somebody said, hey, I have a video camera, small video camera which you have in your house to take pictures of your baby taking the first steps so that you can bore to death your guests, you know, by playing these movies and so on. He said, this is an actual picture of the Crab Nebula taken with a home TV camera. And there is Bode's star pulsing with a period of 33 milliseconds, which is the period at which it pulses in radio. And Crab Nebula was then found to be pulsating in all frequencies, radio, optical, X-rays, gamma rays, ultra-high energy gamma rays and so on. But not all pulsars do. It's a very young pulsar, just born 1,000 years ago. So it is enough energy and strong enough magnetic field. But we'll come to that afterwards. So the period of this pulsar in the Crab Nebula was 33 milliseconds. Its magnetic field was 5 times 10 to the power 12 Gauss, and we'll return to this at the end, how they deduce this magnetic field. Your original question, we'll come to that. And by putting it in that formula, the luminosity is proportional to dot equal to dot 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 b squared omega to the power 4. You get a total luminosity of 10 to the power 38, which matches precisely with the luminosity of the Crab Nebula. So the great mystery was solved. The central engine of the Crab Nebula, which supplies relativistic particles and the magnetic field, is a rapidly rotating, strongly magnetized neutron star. Then it remained to be understood how this object produces relativistic particles and how it produces the magnetic field. So we'll turn to that now. So we have to now discuss how neutron stars function as pulsars. So that remarkable story is now over. So as soon as all this happened, there were two important developments. One was a theoretical development that happened in Caltech in America, and one was an experimental development which Radhakrishnan, formerly of Raman Institute here, he was in Australia at that time, he and an electronics engineer observed, and we'll discuss both of them. Because our present understanding of pulsars 50 years after they were discovered is just where it was on day one, okay? Which is, you can either feel bad about it or you can say how spectacularly successful they were right in the beginning. I leave it to you to decide. First, a few words about pulsars. What is shown here are average pulse profiles of whole lot of pulsars. Average means an individual pulse may differ from the next pulse of a pulsar. So what I can do is, I can put on top of one another 100,000 pulses and say, what is the average pulse from this pulsar? Now that average pulse from a pulsar is like a fingerprint of a person. It is different for each pulsar. It is unique. Like your Aadhaar card or whatever it is. It is unique. Then there is microstructure inside pulses. This tells you that interesting things are happening on distant scales, which are small even compared to the size of a neutron star. Incidentally, there's something very important I forgot to say. When Jocelyn Bell published her paper, they concluded it could be either a white dwarf or a neutron star because its period was 1 second. But when they discovered the Crab pulsar with a period of 33 milliseconds, it immediately ruled out white dwarfs. Only thing that was left was neutron stars. You knew it couldn't be pulsation of neutron star because 1 over square root of 0 will give you a millisecond. This is 33 milliseconds. So it could be rotation of a neutron star. So the picture emerges that pulsars are rapidly rotating, strongly magnetized neutron stars. Yes, I forgot to say how this degeneracy was lifted. So white dwarfs were out. Then it was noticed right from the beginning, as I mentioned, that there is this phenomenon of nulling of pulsars. Pulsars arrived periodically in time, but then they disappear. Sometimes they disappear for days and weeks. And then when they reappear exactly where they should appear if it was a perfect clock. This phenomenon is still not, to the best of my knowledge, still not properly understood. You must appreciate that my knowledge of these things is slightly dated because I am not following the development now. Okay, I'm no longer working in this field. So let us look at the development in Caltech. And that idea there, due to Goldreich and his collaborator Julian, according to them, the neutron star functions like a Faraday's unipolar dynamo. When Faraday made his famous dynamo, the first dynamo he made was a very simple dynamo. It was a uniformly magnetized metallic sphere which is rotating. And it produces a voltage, and if you join the wire to two different points on the surface and connect a bulb, the bulb lit up. They called the Prime Minister of England and showed this. So the Prime Minister, being Prime Minister, promptly said, "What use is it?" He said, "Sir, you'll soon be taxing it." The true story, eh? So if you have a magnet, if you have a sphere of radius 10 centimeters, and it's magnetized to 10,000 Gauss and spinning at some reasonable frequency, it'll produce about 5 volts, enough to light your cycle bulb. That's how a cycle dynamo works. But if my sphere is 10 kilometers in radius, and its magnetic field is not a few Gauss, but 10 to the power 12 Gauss, then the voltage I generate is astronomical, 10 to the power 16 volts or more. Okay. How does this work? Now, you're not expected to understand all the details of this, but I want to say why it produces voltage on the surface. First of all, for simplicity, because the problem is impossible to solve, unless you assume the magnetic axis and the rotation axis are aligned. In a real neutron star, they need not be aligned, and indeed they are not aligned. That's why you get pulses of radiation. We'll come to that in a minute. The Radhakrishnan model of pulsar, lighthouse model of pulsars. Now, this is a solved problem in electrodynamics book, in Landau and Lipschitz, Jackson, and so on. The unipolar inductor will be a solved problem in the books. It's not a very difficult problem to solve. The important thing to appreciate is the following. You know from Thomson's theorem that if I have a metallic sphere, then the surface charge is zero. The charge density on the surface is zero. It's known as Thomson's theorem. In other words, the surface of a metallic sphere is an equipotential. Therefore, the charge has to be the same everywhere. But this is no longer the case. The moment I rotate it, everybody is magnetized. Why is that? Very simple reason. Let's imagine an electron inside the sphere. It is rotating. And it is rotating in a magnetic field. It doesn't matter that the magnetic field is also not an external field, but frozen into it. So that electron moving in the magnetic field experiences a Lorentz force V cross B. But an electron doesn't like to experience a force. It would like to cancel out this force V cross B. So what it does is, it redistributes the charges on the surface so that it creates an electric field E such that the force acting on the charge due to that electric field precisely cancels out the V cross B force. Then you can work out what should be the strength of that electric field. Since the force in an electric field is small e times capital E, then you will find that that electric field will be minus V cross B. So the net force acting on the charge will be zero. So that is the physics of why if I have a uniformly magnetized sphere which is rotating, suddenly surface charges appear. And if you solve this problem, which is solved in the any standard textbook, you will find that if the magnetic field of the sphere is dipolar, in other words, there are only two poles, you'll find that the surface charge distribution is quadrupolar. In other words, there is at the pole, let us say that the charge at the surface is, potential at the surface is zero with respect to some origin, then the maximum potential will be at the equator, then again it will be zero at the pole, and again it will be maximum by symmetry. So symmetry tells me that a dipolar magnetic field will produce a quadrupolar charge distribution. That's what is, so it is P2 cos theta, cos squared theta minus 1, 3 cos squared theta minus 1. That's fine. This is all standard electrodynamics. But the most important thing is the following. As you all know, the electric field inside a metallic sphere will be zero. Again, it follows from Thomson's. In fact, the statement that the surface charge is zero is related to the statement that the electric field is zero using Gauss's theorem and so on. But that doesn't mean you cannot have electric field outside the sphere. So if you look at it, what you find is that outside the star or outside this metallic sphere, there will be an electric field. And in particular, there will be an electric field. I can decompose that electric field as parallel to the magnetic field and perpendicular to the magnetic field, because magnetic field gives me an axis, symmetry axis. The important thing is it will have a electric field component parallel to the magnetic field. We'll forget about perpendicular, because perpendicular thing, anyway, magnetic field is going to dictate terms in the perpendicular direction. So forget about electric fields. So the important thing is, outside the star, there will be an electric field, and in particular, there will be a component of that electric field parallel to the magnetic field. Okay, fine. Now let us discuss the electrodynamics of such a strongly magnetized, rapidly rotating sphere. We are only interested in the underlying physics of how the radiation is produced. We are not going to write any equations. Now, first thing is, we are talking about a potential of the order of 10 to the power 16 between the pole and the equator. Or if I go away, the electrostatic potential also decreases. The important thing is, if I put a test charge on the surface of a neutron star, it will experience a strong electrostatic field, small e into capital E, because of this electric field. It will have a certain numerical value. I can compare that electrostatic force with all other forces acting on that particle, gravitational force, nuclear force, or any force that you may want to, atomic forces, anything. You will find that all forces are insignificant compared to the force experienced by this charge in a voltage drop from 10 to the power 16 to zero at infinity. Therefore, the predominant force acting on any charge will be the electrostatic force due to the electric field. The electric field is going in all directions. But outside the neutron star, there are railway tracks. These railway tracks are our magnetic field lines. This magnetic field is very, very strong, 10 to the power 12 gauss near the surface. So the magnetic field says, go along the railway track, don't leave the track, because V cross B force is incredibly strong. So keep that in mind. Now, therefore, charges will be pulled out of the surface. Well, we have this iron lattice, so there are iron atoms, electrons bound to the nuclei, gravity pulling it down. I don't care about all these things. The electrons will be pulled out, the protons will be pulled out, and they'll be accelerated to ultra-relativistic speeds by this strong electric field. The most important thing is that these charges are allowed to move only along the field line rather than cross the field line, because V cross B force is so enormous. Therefore, the charges that are pulled out and accelerated parallel to the magnetic field by the very strong electric field will be moving like beads on a string, beads on a wire which is curved. They would like to move perpendicular because magnetic field says, but then what will happen is the synchrotron lifetime will be so small that within half a gyration, it will lose all its energy. So essentially, only this parallel movement remains. So synchrotron radiation is unimportant. Another way of saying that is in very strong magnetic field, all the electrons will be in the lowest Landau level, n equal to 1 level of the hydrogen atom. Therefore, there is no radiation. Nothing is going up because the spacing is Eb over gamma mc, which is very, very small. So everything is in the lowest level if you want to look at it from a quantum mechanical point of view. Classically, the synchrotron lifetime will be so short that gyration is unimportant. That is what you must keep that in mind. So right near the surface of a neutron star, although you will have relativistic particles and a magnetic field, you will not have synchrotron radiation. But you will have radiation because the railway track is curved and therefore the electrons are experiencing acceleration. So according to our formula, all we need is acceleration. Okay, fine. Now, something very beautiful happens. Now the charges that are pulled out and accelerated are trapped in the magnetic field lines because the magnetic field says, just follow me. So they'll go from North Pole to South Pole to North Pole, and so on. They are not allowed to move away from the field lines. Now, since the field lines are anchored to the surface, the field lines co-rotate with the star. Therefore, the charges which are sticking to the field lines will also co-rotate with the star. This is what happens on Earth. The charged particles from the Sun, when they enter the Earth's magnetic field, they are trapped by the Earth's magnetic field. Magnetic field says, follow me, don't cross me. So they go to the North Pole and produce an aurora borealis. Then they go to the South Pole and produce aurora borealis. And so you can see the aurora going from north to south. And this was first studied in 1957 when they sent a ship in the Atlantic Ocean and sent off a rocket and exploded an atom bomb, which produced charged particles. And they had calculated when the first aurora will be in the North Pole, when it should be in the South Pole, and so on. So that was the first time we had a confirmation of the theory of aurora borealis. Okay? So charges will co-rotate. So the Earth is a magnetosphere. And this magnetosphere of charged particles going around the Earth trapped to the field line is a serious worry for our satellites. because our satellites have digital electronic equipment which are made of silicon chips or germanium chips, and these charged particles cause tremendous radiation damage. So that is why when they launch these things from Sriharikota, they will be very careful to avoid what is known as a Van Allen belt, which is a belt of charged particles orbiting the Earth. These are particles trapped from the sun, solar wind. Okay, now this collection of charges trapped to the magnetic field, co-rotating with the star, forms the magnetosphere of the neutron star. There it is. Here is a beautiful picture taken from the web. You see that this green area represents the charges which are trapped to the magnetic field, which are rotating. Ah, but there is a beautiful physics problem here. It cannot co-rotate forever and ever because there is this distance, magical distance, which is known as the light cylinder distance. The co-rotating magnetosphere cannot be larger than a certain critical size because it's rotating as a rigid body. V is equal to R omega. So when R becomes larger and larger, at some stage, V will become equal to C. And if they rotate, co-rotate beyond that, then you're going to violate special relativity. You're not allowed to do that, right? So at the critical distance from the star, the co-rotating charges will be moving at the speed of light. Clearly, co-rotation is not possible beyond this radius. And now this important distance has come to be known as the speed of light radius or a light cylinder radius. And its formula is V is R omega, so I set V equal to C. Therefore, the radius of that magical cylinder because of the geometry, co-rotation is parallel to this way, is not a sphere, and is C over omega. So you tell me the angular velocity of rotation of the star, I will tell you up to what distance you can co-rotate. Fine. So that I have shown pictorially, I mean taken from this figure, is here is the light cylinder with the dashed line. And you notice there are two kinds of field lines. There are those field lines that close inside the light cylinder. And there are those field lines that go outside the light cylinder, go to infinity, and come back and rejoin the star. Clearly, co-rotation is only possible for those particles that are trapped in the closed field lines. What happens to particles which are pulled out and moving along field lines which don't close inside the light cylinder? They cannot co-rotate, so they just go off. They just go off. There is no restoring force. They are not forced to co-rotate. So what will happen is, here is a picture which explains what I just said. All the closed field lines, all field lines are closed. It's a question of whether they close inside the light cylinder or go outside the light cylinder and come and close. All those field lines which close inside the light cylinder will have charged particles and there will be the rotating magnetosphere. And along the open field lines, particles of any charge that are pulled out will race away to infinity. So charges moving along field lines that cross the light cylinder will escape from the star. These are the charges that fill the Crab Nebula. Remember, we are talking about a very small distance from the neutron star, which is only 10 kilometers in size. We are talking of Crab Nebula, which is several light years in size. That is filled with electrons and positrons emitting synchrotron radiation. These particles, we said, are supplied by the central engine. This is how it supplies it. Okay? So we still haven't said where the positrons come from. We'll do that in a minute. Because there are no positrons inside the neutron star. You can only pull out electrons and ions, right? Fine. Now the radiation from the nebula is the radiation emitted by these particles gyrating far away in the magnetic field of the nebula. That is Shklovsky's prediction. So this is exactly what Shklovsky had predicted long time ago, way back in 1960. He said that there's particles emitting synchrotron radiation at high frequencies, visible X-rays, gamma rays, are emitted all the time from a central object. And that's what it is. Now, let's calculate the luminosity. We said the luminosity is given by B squared r to the power 6 omega to the power 4. That's because the magnetic moment has been replaced by BR cube. And the luminosity is proportional to the square of the magnetic field and the fourth power of the frequency. Now, let us recall what we discussed in the last lecture. We said an electron moving in a curved path will radiate. Our electrons are moving in a curved path because they are trapped to the field lines and the field lines are curved, and therefore they will radiate. This radiation is known as curvature radiation. This phrase was first coined by Radhakrishnan because this is the first instance we knew of a particle which is radiating, which is not due to gyration in a magnetic field, or it is just because the field lines are curved. They are being accelerated in an electric field. And that electric field is parallel to the magnetic field. And this radiation will be polarized. We also know that if the particle is non-relativistic, then the polarization can be either plane polarized, circularly polarized, or elliptic polarized, depending upon your viewing geometry of the instantaneous trajectory of the particle, which is a small section of this circle. But we also said in the last lecture, that was the purpose of the last lecture, that if you are dealing with a relativistic charge, the radiation is highly beamed in the forward direction and essentially confined to the plane of the orbit because the opening angle of the cone is 1 over gamma, where gamma is 1 over square root of 1 minus v squared by c squared, which is a very large number. And we also said that this radiation will be not monochromatic, will be broadband, but there will be a characteristic frequency which is given by gamma cubed times the gyration frequency, and the radiation will be linearly polarized, and the plane of polarization will be the plane of the orbit. Okay? So now we go from Caltech, cross the Pacific Ocean and go to Sydney in Australia, where Radhakrishnan was working. Okay, before that. So, how do we explain, jump the story, I got my slides sequence wrong. How does the radio radiation emanate from pulsars? Is it this radiation we are talking about? Electrons accelerated, moving in a curved path? No, because that radiation will be ultra high energy gamma rays. Why will it be ultra high? Okay, I have gone to this. So we'll come to that in a moment. We'll defer that, okay? So I claim this radiation is not radio radiation, it's not visible or X-ray. It'll be ultra high energy gamma ray radiation. Why? Because we said the characteristic frequency of the radiation will be gamma cubed times the characteristic frequency of the non-relativistic radiation. And since gamma is very, very large, million, 10 million, 100 million, you're talking about ultra-high energy gamma rays. So we have to find a clever mechanism of converting those radiation to radio radiation. It's a very clever mechanism. We'll come to that presently. Okay. So as I said, Cook was an electronics engineer. So the interpretation is entirely due to Radhakrishnan. And this work was done at the same time as Goldreich and Julian's work in Caltech. They didn't know about one another's result at the same time. Now, this is pure observation and pure deduction, sublime deductions from observations. And you'll see how they both come to the same conclusion. Okay? That is a beautiful thing. What Radhakrishnan and Cook concluded was that the radio radiation is emanating right from the surface of the neutron star. Surface meaning very close to the surface of the neutron star. That's important, very close to the surface of the neutron star. And because that opening angle of the cone is very, very small, and because the magnetic axis need not be aligned with the rotation axis, that beam of radiation will appear pulsed. You will only see it, in other words, if I get on a rocket and move away from the sun to some other part of the galaxy, I may not be able to see the crab pulsar because that beam will miss me. This is a lighthouse beam will miss me if I don't look in the right direction. Okay. If I go above or below, I won't see it, right? What made them say that the radio radiation is coming from very close to the magnetic poles? That was this beautiful observation. That was vintage Radhakrishnan. He was not a theoretical physicist, either by training or by education. He had no feeling for mathematical subtleties, but he had a very deep physical insight. What he said was, look, here are the pulses. Others had also seen pulsars by then, because this is post Jocelyn Bell's paper appearing in Nature. But he said, I'm going to measure the polarization of the radiation, which nobody else in the world had done. Nobody else in the world thought polarization should be measured. And what he found was the following. Inside a given pulse, which you see there, the pulse has a certain duration, delta t. At each instant of time within that delta t, he measured the direction of polarization. And that direction of polarization seemed like the Japanese fan. This is shown over there. So the arrows inside the pulse is the direction of polarization. So within the pulse, the direction of polarization is changing like a Japanese fan. Good? Fine. Now, I know a lot of you thought I was completely crazy. It's a beautiful sunny day with no clouds, but I came here with an umbrella. I'm going to open this umbrella. By the way, these are various constellations. And so in the night, if you go, you can actually see the constellations, and they're all named. Anyway, that's not what I want to describe. I want you to think a little hard about the following. I want you to imagine that these spokes of the umbrella are magnetic field lines of a dipole magnet. In one sense, this is not correct depiction of it. Imagine that it comes out and goes. Okay, that is missing here, okay? You have to imagine this doesn't meet here. This goes here and goes down, and imagine this is the pole, okay? I had actually made a model like there was wires, but I couldn't find it in the house where it was. So, and this is it. So what you're seeing is a projection of the field lines. So the projection of the field lines to you will look like the top picture there, like the spokes of a cycle wheel. Yes or no? You agree? The projection of the field lines, you understand what I mean by projection, will be like the top picture on the left. Fine. Please remember that the field lines are not emanating from here, but from here. In other words, it is going out like this. Are you willing to visualize this? Okay. So now I'm going to, each of you are different observers, or one observer, you, is observing at different times within the pulse. Okay? Different times. So first, let me concentrate on you. What you'll see is that there are field lines, there are electrons that are coming out here and going here. That radiation will be confined to this plane, so it won't reach you. You will only see radiation from that field line where the line of sight is in the plane of the orbit. You agree? This person will see from a different field line. You will see it from a different field line. you will see it from a different field line. You will say the plane of polarization is the plane of that orbit. This orbit, this orbit, this orbit, this orbit. It's the same thing as if I was rotating, okay? So whether you think of same person or viewing it at different times, or different persons viewing at the same time within the pulse. So the point I'm making is, if the radiation emanated from very close to the magnetic pole, then the plane of polarization will give me the geometry of the projected field lines. And that was a brilliant deduction that Radhakrishnan made, that from what the plane of polarization is doing within a pulse is it is sweeping an angle like this. That can be explained if that is a magnetic pole and field lines are coming out of it, but what you're seeing there is the projection of the field line and your line of sight is cutting it like this, then you will see plane of polarization like this, okay? So the first deduction is the sweep of the plane of polarization is telling me about the geometry of field lines, and the geometry that I deduce from observation corresponds to field lines very close to the pole. So this is how they concluded that the radio radiation must be emanating from very close to the surface of the neutron star. Because the radiation is linearly polarized, it had to be relativistic particles. And because the relativistic particles are radiating, it must be curvature radiation. And because it is curvature radiation, it will be a hollow cone. Why will it be a hollow cone? The central field lines hardly curve. Therefore, particles that are accelerating about the central field lines, they will not produce much radiation because the radius of curvature is practically infinity. So, please remember, all of this is just from one single observation, namely the sweep of the angle of polarization. They deduced that the radiation is due to relativistic electrons moving along the field lines producing curvature radiation. Why they produce a relativistic electron, they have nothing to say. But then that Goldreich and Julian had explained around the same time. So this model, which is the polar cap model of pulsars, has stuck exactly 50 years after this model was proposed. This is still the model of pulsars. Namely, it functions like a lighthouse of highly collimated beams emanating from the magnetic poles. Okay? On the duty cycle of the pulsar, duty cycle is, here is a pulse, then there is no energy, then there is the next pulse. Duty cycle is the fraction of the time the pulse is radiating within a period. That tells me what is the solid angle subtended by the cone. So we know that the solid angle swept by the cone is 1/5 of 4 pi. That means we only see 1/5 of all the pulsars that are there in our galaxy. The others are not beaming towards us. Okay. 1/5 comes from observation. Maybe small, different this way or that way. Now the crab pulsar, this is the profile of the crab pulsar. So don't think that this is one pulse and this is the next pulse. No, the next pulse is here. Once again, both those things are repeated. So each pulse seems to come twice. And that was explained by the Radhakrishnan Cook model, saying that, look, in a rare circumstance, like in the crab pulsar, the magnetic axis is perpendicular to the rotation axis. So you see both pulses, both poles. North pole, south pole, north pole, south pole. Okay? In other cases, you will only see one pole. Some other part of the galaxy, you will see the other pole. But in this case, there are a few pulsars where you see both the poles. So let's go back to radio radiation from pulsars. As I said before, you expect this curvature radiation to be in gamma rays because the characteristic frequency will be the gyration frequency, which is EB over gamma MC multiplied by gamma cube. And that you expect it to be in the high energy gamma ray region. Okay, so this goes back to what we were discussing before the lecture began. We know that this process of a photon decaying into an electron-positron pair cannot happen because you cannot simultaneously satisfy both energy and momentum conservation. But as you rightly pointed out, this can happen. You can have two photons creating a pair, or a pair decaying into two photons. That is allowed. But you can also have the following thing. You can have a photon interacting with an atomic nucleus, and the nucleus supplies the necessary momentum to satisfy energy momentum conservation. Then you can, a single photon can produce two pairs. That you see that in the atmosphere all the time. If you go to Ooty, the Cherenkov mirrors, you will see a gamma ray comes, it produces electron positron. Okay, because it interacts with the nucleus in the Earth's atmosphere. So all you need is some friendly donor who will give you some momentum, or a sink to take some momentum, depending on what you need to satisfy energy and momentum conservation. But this is all well known. One of the other things that can give you momentum and take away momentum is the magnetic field, because the magnetic field lines have a tension. If I plug a magnetic field line in a conducting medium, it'll oscillate. And those oscillations can be Fourier analyzed. Those are the Alfvén waves. So if a photon hits a magnetic field line, then it can either absorb or give take momentum, depending on what is needed. And a photon can create an electron-positron pair. This is only likely to happen in very high magnetic field. So that's what I've tried to explain in this slide. Imagine there is an original photon. Let us say that green line is one original photon. And that creates a, he hits this field line and produces an electron-positron pair. The electrons and positrons will be accelerated in the opposite direction, because one will be the, your parallel plate capacitor, 10 to the power 16 volts, zero at infinity. So depending on the sign of the charge, they will be accelerated this way or that way. They are both moving along curved field lines, so both will produce a photon. That photon will go and hit the next field line and produce another electron-positron pair. So a single photon will very quickly produce 10 to the power 45 electrons and 10 to the power 45 positrons. You have that much energy, the original gamma ray then decays to a very large number of low energy electrons and positrons, whose gamma is very, very small. Therefore, gamma cubed times characteristic frequency is now in the radio radiation. The kind of field, the quantum electrodynamics tells you exactly what will be the mean free path of the photon in a magnetic field. The mean free path of the photon in a magnetic field is proportional to exponential to the power 1 over chi, where chi is the perpendicular component of the magnetic field divided by some quantum field, which is of the order of 10 to the power 13 Gauss. So don't worry about all that. I only want you to appreciate what is written here by hand, namely that the mean free path of a photon in a very strong magnetic field is exponentially small. So if I produce a gamma ray, ultra-high energy gamma ray photon at the magnetic pole, very quickly I will end up with the electron-positron cascade. Okay, that's the experiment. If you go to Ooty, you'll see a TIFR experiment where the gamma rays from the Crab Nebula or somewhere comes to the upper atmosphere, produces an electron-positron pair. That each electron and positron produce further pairs, further pair, further pair. Then you have a shower. And so on the ground, the shower could be either a mu meson or electron. So they have a shower, I mean detectors, very large array of detectors on the ground to detect these charged particles, either mu mesons or electrons and positrons. Okay, fine. So, to cut the story short, you have this co-rotating magnetospheres charged particles trapped to field lines that close inside the light cylinder. There are no astrophysical consequences of that. What causes the radiation we receive and detect is radiation of particles along the open field lines, and our story has got to the point that the original gamma ray has resulted in electron-positron pairs, and it is these pairs that finally radiate the radio radiation. And it is these electrons which then go to the Crab Nebula far, far, far away and produce the observed radio radiation from the Crab Nebula. Because in the case of the Crab Nebula, you not only need to produce a mechanism for producing the relativistic particle, you also have to produce the required number to explain the luminosity at any given wavelength. So you can't do with just the original numbers that are pulled out of the surface. You need this enormous amplification, cascading. So here it is. But now, when these particles, electrons and positrons, move far away from the neutron star, come near the light cylinder, the magnetic field is much weaker near the light cylinder. What is the light cylinder radius? C over omega. A dipole field decreases 1 over r cubed. So far away from the neutron star, the field will not be 10 to the power 12 gauss. It may be 1 gauss or 1/100th of a gauss. Whereas near the neutron star surface, the particles were forced to move along the field lines because magnetic field said, don't cross me, V cross B force is too large. Far away from the star, V cross B force will be very small, and therefore the electrons and positrons can defy the magnetic field and gyrate and produce good old synchrotron radiation. And that's what I have indicated there. Very close to the surface of the star, you have curvature radiation. Far away from the neutron star, not in the nebula, you're still near the light cylinder. Okay, we have many tens of radii, but you are not in light years away. You are still in talking of hundreds of kilometers or so. You will have synchrotron radiation. So here it is, to summarize what I said. Near the star, the field is strong and the charges can only slide along the field lines. Since the field lines are curving, they will radiate curvature radiation in a narrow cone, and the axis of the cone will be tangent to the field lines. And this is how the radio radiation from pulsars is produced. Now, near the light cylinder, the field is weaker and the charges can gyrate and produce synchrotron radiation. This is how the optical X-ray and gamma rays from the pulsar are produced. We are not talking of the nebula. The Crab pulsar produces pulsed X-rays, pulsed visible, pulsed gamma rays. Those are synchrotron radiation, okay? Not curvature radiation. And they eventually leave the light cylinder and fill this expanding balloon. What is the balloon? The debris of the supernova that occurred in 1054 AD. That balloon is being pumped with magnetic field and relativistic particles. As you will say, but I haven't said anything about magnetic field because I don't have enough time to discuss it. But basically, the point is the following, that this relativistic wind from the rotating neutron star carries with it also the magnetic field. The best way to visualize that is the following. Imagine on the top of the table, imagine the walls of this room are made of conducting material. And in the center of the room, I have a dipole magnet. That's my neutron star. And the walls are the boundaries of my supernova remnant, the Crab Nebula. So the field lines eventually go there, and they are frozen into that conducting wall. Meanwhile, the magnet in the center of this room is rotating once every 33 milliseconds. In the olden days, I don't know if any of you have seen it, in the olden days, you had to have you have to wind a clock every day. There's a spring which you wind, and that gives you the potential energy, which then makes a little pendulum oscillate. So as the neutron star rotates, these magnetic field lines, which are trapped to the surface there because it's conducting, is actually getting wound up. One winding for every turn of the neutron star. You understand? Like the spring of a clock. So what Goldreich and Julian had predicted in 1969 is that this relativistic wind about which we are talking about also carries with it a magnetic field, and it's a toroidal magnetic field like the one that I just described. This is a poloidal field, dipole field. Toroidal field is like a coil. That's what will happen if I spin a magnet here and anchor the field lines at the surface. That's what you see here in the Chandra image of the Crab Nebula. Right at the center of the Crab Pulsar, and this X-ray emission clearly gives you the geometry of the field lines. It's like a ceiling fan. And there is the pulsar. And there is the relativistic wind that Walter Bode saw in 1962. These are the wisps produced by the central pulsar. Okay? So this spectacular picture of the central region of the Crab Nebula by the Chandra X-ray Observatory is clear proof of the toroidal magnetic field of the Crab Nebula, that the field is toroidal and that the toroidal field is supplied by the central rotating magnet. So there it is. So that is the remarkable story of the Crab Nebula. Today we know 2,500 pulsars, some in nearby galaxies. These are not the only neutron stars that we have detected. We will later talk about neutron stars which emit X-rays, which is not coming from a dynamo. That is simply coming from a simple reason that something falls on it. If it rains on the neutron star, it will emit X-rays because the gravitational potential energy is released as X-ray. So Chandra Observatory has seen hundreds and hundreds of those that we will discuss separately. But here we are talking about objects whose radiation is due to, these are isolated magnets, rotating magnets, where the energy that is being radiated is the stored rotational energy of the star. Okay, fine. So before we have questions, I'll tell you about the next lecture. The remaining questions that we want to understand pertain to questions like the maximum mass of a neutron star and, of course, black holes. Now, in a neutron star of 10 kilometers in radius, gravity is sufficiently strong that you have to invoke general relativity to understand things quantitatively. You cannot describe gravity by Newton's laws. And, of course, when we want to discuss black holes, we have to discuss general relativity. Now, obviously, I cannot discuss in one lecture a subject as complex and mathematically intricate as general theory of relativity. Chandrasekhar spent the last 25 years of his life and writing a book of some 1,000 pages just on black holes. But my purpose in the next lecture will be to try to get you to understand the essential physical content of the general theory of relativity. And that's all we need to do. And that is possible in an extremely elementary fashion. So we will aim to do that in the next lecture. Are there any questions in today's lecture? Yes. I'm listening.
And like all throughout the rotation. So they'll be relativistic near the equator also, right? So why don't we see radiation coming from...
Why will they... They are still sliding along the field lines.
Yeah, so there will be some the curvature emission will be there, right?
Curvature radiation? But that will not come towards you, right? The point is that will not be radiation. They may emit radiation like aurora borealis is caused by the energy being transmitted to atoms and molecules in the atmosphere. So in that sense, they can lose energy. I'm not sure. I mean, you're asking a very interesting question. Are there any astrophysical consequences of the co-rotating magnetosphere? Well, there could be, for example, also the following thing. A co-rotating charge like this will produce a toroidal magnetic field. That toroidal magnetic field can slightly modify your original poloidal magnetic field due to the frozen magnet inside. People have studied these things as theoretical problems, but I'm not aware of people, I'm a bit outdated, please forgive me for that, but at the time when I did study the literature carefully, people have not taken it to the point of what are the astrophysical consequences of that sort of thing. Let me think a little more about the question you raised. But the question you raised is not just near the equator, everywhere. Everywhere.
It's pointing at
the Your question is, will these particles lose energy? I think it's a... there is a subtle problem here which I tried to point out to you. This may or may not answer your question, but it is sufficiently interesting that I'll point it to you, okay? Now, let us say a particle is moving in this direction. It's emitting radiation. Okay, call it what you like, curvature radiation in this case, because I didn't say what is making it go around. It could be magnetic field, synchrotron radiation, and so on. But this radiation carries away not only energy, but also carries away angular momentum, right? So when an electron in an atom jumps from, say, n equal to 2 to n equal to 1, or n equal to 3 to 2, you not only, this photon carries not only the difference in energy, but there's also a difference in, you are jumping from a p state to a state. That means your angular momentum is changing. In the case of the orbital angular momentum. So the photon has to carry the angular momentum. So that angular momentum conservation is satisfied by the atom. So you have to satisfy both energy conservation and angular momentum conservation. So I'm detecting this photon from far away. And the interesting thing is, I project the trajectory of the photon backwards in time, backwards in space. And ask at what distance from the center that photon was emitted. It'll be emitted at the distance where energy and angular momentum will be conserved. It will not appear to you come from the particle itself. It'll appear to you to come from an imaginary distance where of such a radius of curvature and speed so that angular momentum conservation is also satisfied. You know what that imaginary radius is? That is the light cylinder radius. So it is only at that distance, which is C over omega, where both energy and angular momentum are conserved. So my own feeling is, answer to your question, I need to think a little more deeply about your question, is that from inside the light cylinder, if you try to emit radiation, you may not be able to satisfy angular momentum conservation. This is very elementary to prove. All you're saying is you detect radiation, it's coming from a certain direction. Imagine it's coming from a particle orbiting. You will find it coming from along a tangent to an imaginary circle of such a radius that angular momentum conservation will be satisfied. And that is the light cylinder radius. That is not the context in which we introduce the light cylinder. We introduced it in the context that the velocity will be equal to c. But it also happens to be this magical. But let me think about this. I don't think there'll be any astrophysical consequence. My own feeling is anything coming from inside the light cylinder, other than the charges that are going. Yeah. Any other question? Yes. Please.
Why do you have that emission cones for relativistic particles only?
Why?
I mean, is it just like a convention for the line of sight to simplify that thing?
No. See, I have a non-relativistic particle emits radiation. whose angular distribution is given by 1 plus cos squared theta, as I calculated yesterday and showed you. You Lorentz transform that pattern to a frame which is moving at relativistic speed with respect to you. In that frame, it will be a narrow cone. You can do the calculation and show it. See, the thing is, I gave simple arguments for why it should be a pulsed and narrow cone and so on. But if you look in books in electrodynamics, they'll do an honest calculation of that. That is simply, you have to do a Lorentz transformation of an angular distribution to a relativistically moving frame. And in that frame, you'll find that the radiation, this is known as aberration in special relativity. This phenomena of dependence of angles on a Lorentz transformation is known as aberration. So the fact that a more or less isotropic distribution becomes beamed in the forward direction is a result of extreme aberration. It's a pure special relativity effect. Any other? Yes? Ah, yes, you had a question. Well, that's rather easy, actually. Let's try to understand this. We said a rotating magnet produces radiation whose luminosity is minus b squared dot 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 b squared omega to the power 4. Where does this energy come from? You cannot produce energy from a DC magnetic field. If you could, you'd be very rich. You can only produce energy from a time-varying magnetic field. So this energy is coming at the expense of the stored rotational energy, half I omega squared. Therefore, omega omega dot is proportional to b squared omega to the power 4. Therefore, omega dot is proportional to b squared omega cubed. If I now introduce 2 pi p is equal to omega, the p is the period of rotation, then this equation becomes p, p dot is proportional to b squared, where p dot is the time derivative of the period. So what you find is that these pulsars, this was first measured by Radhakrishnan, period derivative. So when the pulsar is radiating, its period is also lengthening. For some pulsars like the Crab and Vela pulsar, between morning and evening, you can measure the slowdown of the pulsar, slowdown of the rotation, because frequencies are measured very accurately. And since radio astronomers measure frequencies, they can measure very small changes, okay? Therefore, to answer your question, what observers measure, the measured quantity of any pulsar, the measured quantities are the period and the period derivative. And this immediately gives you the magnetic field. Square of the magnetic field is proportional to pp dot. Or in other words, p dot, which is dp by dt, is equal to b squared by period. So stronger the magnetic field, more rapidly it will slow down. Faster it is rotating, more rapidly it will slow down. So a neutron star will begin its life by rapidly losing energy As it loses energy, it will slow down less and less and less and less. So that is how you measure the magnetic fields of neutron stars. So what is the typical number? If you take, for example, the Crab pulsar, its period derivative is of the order of 10 to the power minus 14 seconds per second. Now you may say that's not a very large number, but since frequencies can be measured very accurately, between morning and evening you can detect the slowdown of the Crab pulsar. But we will also discuss pulsars in one of the later lectures. These are the millisecond pulsars, whose slowdown rate is of the order of 10 to the power minus 19 seconds per second. So in the entire history of the universe, they only lost 1 millisecond. So in 10 billion years, they will lose 1 millisecond. So you can see, therefore, millisecond pulsars will be as good a clock as atomic clocks. And as we'll see, atomic clocks which define the standard of time are compared every day with 2 or 3 millisecond pulsars for long-term calibration. We will come to that story separately. Yeah. So this is how we measure 2,500 pulsars. The summary is, except for the millisecond pulsar, which is a separate story, and we'll come to that, because gravitational waves and so on, you expect from only from very, very fast objects, because we said gravitational radiation is proportional to 6th power of the frequency. Why? Square of the 3rd time derivative of the quadrupole moment. Omega times omega times omega whole square is omega to the power 6. So the faster the object spins, more. So we are only interested in millisecond pulsars. So we'll come to that. But the point I wanted to say is, yes, if you leave out those millisecond pulsars, about 120 of them, for the remaining 2,500, the magnetic field centers around 10 to the power 12 to 10 to the power 13 Gauss. So most of them have very high fields. Some have much higher fields, 10 to the power 15 or so, but they are very, very small in number, half a dozen or a dozen or so. So almost all the original predictions made long before neutron stars were discovered are now turning out to be quantitatively verified. Any other questions? I have no idea. So it is very vaguely, I'll tell you the direction in which people were thinking some years ago. So it's like lightning. So basically what happens is, I had a slide but I didn't spend time on it. So you have a parallel plate capacitor. One plate is the surface of the neutron star. Other plate is not infinity, because this 10 to the power 16 volts is not happening between there and infinity. It's happening between there and some short distance. Okay, maybe fraction of a kilometer or so. So you have a parallel plate capacitor, if you like, voltage drop. So I am now creating an electron-positron cascade there. Some gamma ray is produced, which produces a cascade of electron-positron pairs and so on. So what will happen? This capacitor will be short-circuited now, because you produce so many charges that this voltage difference between the two plates of the capacitor has been shorted out. So for a very short time, the capacitor will be ineffective till these charges, everything goes to that plate or this plate, once again the voltage develops. So a pulsar is like not just a dynamo, but a sparking dynamo. So there are lightnings, if you like, in the capacitor. Lightning in the sense of electrical discharges, which produces this very large number of electron-positron pairs. What about the micro pulses within a pulse? Inside a given pulse, you see structures. People understand that by saying, if this is the magnetic pole of a neutron star, it's as big as Bangalore, 10 kilometers, the actual playing area is like a football field size, few meters by few meters near the pole. That's where all the action is taking place. That's where all these open field lines are. other field lines curve and close inside. So they think that this electrical discharge is happening in various places. And it seems to have a memory. Okay, where it strikes, it doesn't strike again till one period later. So it's a question of how this memory is stored. I have no idea about it, but I know this is the kind of direction in which the electrodynamics is going, was going some 30 years ago when I last tried to understand these things. But as far as I know, it has not been understood. Whether the level of understanding is improved, that I am not in a position to tell you. Yeah. Any other question? Jocelyn Bell was here 2 years ago. Not here, she gave a talk in Institute of Astrophysics. Yes. Good, yes. Did I say that? No, why do you say that?
So all neutron stars aren't pulsars, right?
How do you know? I'm saying that all rotating neutron stars will act as pulsars. The question is whether the pulsars get out or not. If the neutron star is surrounded by some matter due to some other reasons, then this radiation will not escape. But deep inside, see, it's like this. You have a dynamo. Sometimes if it is extremely moist outside, the dynamo may not work because the voltage you generate is being shorted out due to the damp atmosphere, okay? The analog of that for a neutron star would be if there is some other matter from a companion star or something like that, which is short-circuiting this dynamo, okay? Otherwise, I would expect every neutron star to function. Whether the radiation escapes or not is a different matter, okay? Provided it's spinning fast enough. No, let me answer your question. It's actually a very interesting question. Let me ask you. When neutron stars become old, they die. Pulsars die. They don't die as neutron stars. They live forever as neutron stars. The voltage generated by a dynamo is proportional to B squared divided by P. Or B squared by P squared, I think. Or the square of the voltage, which is the intensity of radiation, is proportional to B squared to the P to the power 4, which is B squared omega to the power 4, right? Our good old Rayleigh's formula. So as the neutron star slows down, spins down, or the magnetic field decays, the radiation the voltage it will produce will become less and less. Now to produce electron-positron pairs, you need gamma ray of a certain minimum energy, right? 2mc squared. So when the voltage drops below a critical value, the dynamo will switch off. In the sense, it is still rotating, it is still losing energy as some electromagnetic waves, but it will not be producing electron-positron pairs. So it will not be producing radio radiation and so on. It can produce, a rotating magnet has to radiate. The radiation will be at the frequency of rotation. So if it is rotating once every second, the radiation will be a 1 hertz, not radio waves. The radiation will be a 1 hertz, low frequency radiation, right? That is not what we are detecting. We are saying there is some fancy quantum electrodynamic effect taking place where high energy photon creates pairs and so on. This pair creation abruptly stops. So very old neutron stars which are not spinning fast enough or whose magnetic field is not strong enough switch off as pulsars. They continue to be rotating neutron stars emitting low frequency electric dipole radiation or magnetic dipole radiation. Remember, the radiation from a rotating oscillating dipole will be at the same frequency as the frequency of rotation. That is not the frequency we are measuring. Right? We are measuring hundreds of megahertz or 10 to the power 18 hertz, 10 to the power 20 hertz, and so on, right? But that's not the frequency at which it's rotating. Yeah. Good. So we meet on next Wednesday to discuss general relativity. Thank you very much.